Welcome back. We're honored to have with us in the program Dr. Alia Ibrahim, a consultant, internal and pulmonary medicine, head of the pulmonary unit at Jabir Hospital. Welcome to Medical Talk, Doctor.
Thank you for having me tonight.
Thank you. We have so many questions, but I want to start with when we discuss basically the respiratory diseases in general, we would like to know at the beginning how common are respiratory diseases in Kuwait in general.
Well, as you know, our weather is really nice, so it's really common to have respiratory diseases because of our weather changes, as well as we have a lot of pollens, and as well as we have a lot of smokers. When I talk about smoking, I include smoking cigarettes, shisha, vaping, all the kind of e-cigarettes, all the kind of smoking. So that's the second cause why we have a lot of respiratory diseases as well. And also we have other diseases that is related to some environmental and occupational related diseases. And also because we have a lot of people that are that take care of animals, pets and birds. So this is also related to the respiratory system and respiratory diseases. So it is really common. We have a lot of respiratory diseases. In Kuwait, and we have a genetic factor as well, so it is quite common.
So it's a combination between environmental and other factors that actually enhance the chances of
100%,
having.
100%.
So I want to ask you, what are the most common respiratory diseases that you see in the clinic on a daily basis?
Well, as you know, again, we see a lot of bronchial asthma cases. We see a lot of chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, which is the disease that is related to smoking. We see as well a lot of interstitial lung disease and fibrosis and connective tissue disease related fibrosis as well, because we have a lot of patients who have rheumatoid arthritis, systemic lupus and other connective tissue disease related. And as well, we see a lot of obstructive sleep apnea because, as you know, Kuwait has a very high prevalence of obesity. And obesity is the major cause of obstructive sleep apnea. So these are basically the more common diseases that we see in our daily practice.
Okay. You mentioned bronchial asthma. I want to highlight that condition specifically. What is it? Can you give us a definition? Because a lot of people, they confuse bronchial asthma with other things. So if you can give a definition of what's a bronchial asthma and how it's different from other respiratory diseases.
Sure. To start with, I would like to just make sure that people know that bronchial asthma is a chronic disease. So it's just like hypertension, diabetes. When a patient is diagnosed with bronchial asthma, this means that they will live with it. It doesn't mean that they will be on treatment all their lives, but they will have it and can exacerbate it anytime. So it's a chronic disease, and the reason for it are so many. I'm going to speak about them more maybe later on. However, what happens basically is that the airways get inflamed and narrowed, so secretions will be more, and then the mucus will be more, so they are more prone to the feeling of shortness of breath and different symptoms that happens in bronchial asthma.
Okay, so basically it's a narrowing
it's an airway disease, we call it.
It's an airway, basically. And it has a more of a, like a physical, mechanical component to it, basically.
It has extrinsic and intrinsic components, and usually the airways get inflamed, and the pathophysiology of the airways get changed, and this is usually reversible. That's why we say it's very important and necessary to diagnose bronchial asthma as soon as possible to prevent its complications and prevent it being from reversible disease to irreversible disease in the end stages of it.
Okay, we're going to talk about the complications. I want to go back to the causes.
Yes.
Can you tell us what are the causes for bronchial asthma?
Sure. So basically, if we want to divide the causes of bronchial asthma, we'll divide them into allergic causes and non-allergic causes. And usually the allergic causes are things like pet dander, pollens, molds, and other allergens that affect, or the airways will be sensitized to and sense it, and then the narrowing and inflammation and mucus production occurs. And the non-allergic is related to other things like smoking, exercise, we have perfumes, bukhur, we have a lot of In our culture, we use a lot of buhur, so it's very common to cause
the smoke of it.
The smoke of it, exactly. Yeah. And other stuff, like other occupations that might be related as well to cause bronchial asthma, like the painters, bakery, and others. Mm. So it's divided into either allergic or non-allergic, and each one has its own pathway, and usually the treatment somehow we can say similar, but it might be different in specifically nowadays with the new treatment that are available.
Okay. When you mentioned earlier about the environmental factors, what do you mean by that?
So when we say environmental factors, so any change in weather, like whether it's rainy, dusty, humid, cold, sometimes even hot. So each patient or each person might be sensitive to a specific weather kind. Like some of the patients will feel that they will have their bronchial asthma triggered by dusty, for example, environment, whereas others might have them triggered by a humid or rain environment. So any change in environment might lead to the airway inflammation and the secretions as well.
Got it. So in your opinion, who's at risk for bronchial asthma?
So who's at risk? We have a lot of patients that can be, anybody can be at risk, because bronchial asthma is a chronic disease that can occur with a cause or without. So genetically, like if you if the patient has a family history of any atopy, and when we say atopy, we mean bronchial asthma, allergic rhinitis, and eczema. So these three diseases are related to each other. They're like in one family.
They're like linked to each
other. It's linked with each other. So we always ask the patient whether they have a family history of either eczema, allergic rhinitis, and bronchial asthma. It doesn't have to be the three together. So those patients who have a genetic factor are at more risk, as well as smokers, of course, are at more risk, or those patients who have different allergens like pets, birds, if they have weather changes that affects their airways. And we have something called exercise-induced asthma, where they have the asthma only with exercise. So we have so many patients that can be at risk. But what you need to know is that asthma is not related to an age. So many of the people have a misconception that, well, they come and tell me, doctor, how do you diagnose me as asthma at this age? When I was young, I didn't have asthma. It's not related. Yes, most of the cases are at a younger age. However, it can be diagnosed as well in adulthood. And this is even, usually they are more progressive, they are difficult to treat, and they might need a lot of different medications and complications of asthma.
Exactly. We have more questions for you, but we have to take a short break. Stay with us, we'll be right back.
Sure.
Welcome back. We're still talking to Dr. Ali Ibrahim. Doctor, before the break, we were talking about bronchial asthma and the causes and who is more prone, basically, to have it. I want to ask you now about the symptoms of bronchial asthma. I want to just dive specifically on the symptoms, because this is important to distinguish between bronchial asthma and other things. So can you explain to us the symptoms of bronchial asthma?
True. However, to be honest with you, most of the respiratory diseases, unfortunately, they have similar symptoms.
They mimic each other.
But the good thing is that they will have a differentiation in specific symptoms. For example, usually asthmatic patients, they will have shortness of breath that has a triggering factor, like weather changes, or they exercise, or maybe a pet, or some pollens in the pollen season. For example, in Kuwait, our main pollen season is now in September, October, November. So usually they will complain with a triggering factor. So they will have shortness of breath, they will have chest tightness, they feel that they cannot take a good breathing, and they will have a whistling sound, we call it a wheeze.
The wheezing.
So they will hear like whistling sounds. And also they will have cough, and the cough is usually, it might be dry, or sometimes it can be productive depending on the cause of the exacerbation. But the important thing that usually asthmatics will complain at night while sleeping, or when they wake up in the early in the morning. So they have specific timings in which we call it diurnal variations. So maybe they are very well throughout the day, then later on at night, they start to have the symptoms. However, still sometimes it's the vice versa, where they are not well in the morning and at night they can sleep. But to be honest with you, the symptoms just mimics other diseases, but it's more common to hear a wheeze or to have a dry cough at night with asthmatic patients. And we always ask about triggering factors in the history, family history, atopy, and other things as well.
Does time play a factor in this equation? I mean, does the symptoms worsen over time?
It depends. Some patients, if they were diagnosed early and treated well and they're compliant to their treatments and follow-ups. Most of these patients, as I said in the beginning, asthma is a reversible disease. So when diagnosed at the right time with a good treatment and follow-up, usually those patients will have no symptoms and they can live their lives normally. We always say in asthma, our main goal of therapy or treatment is to live normally. So the patient can just go to work regularly, they can just do their hobbies. For example, children should go to school without absences and with no symptoms and play.
No interruption in their life.
Interruptions. Yeah. So if they are treated well and diagnosed early, most of them will be very well and will just live their life. And we have a lot of athletes that are asthmatics, swimmers, marathon, and others.
Yeah.
But if you just say, well, unfortunately, in our culture, we have a lot of, we can say, parents that, or maybe even the patient themselves, ignore their symptoms. They will say, so what? Everybody has cough. So what?
It's just an allergy.
It's just an allergy. Yeah. And they have to know allergy means bronchial asthma.
Okay.
Whenever we say allergy, it means, it's just like saying Alia. It's just the same thing.
It's synchronized.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So they should not just ignore their symptoms. At least they go and check up once and make sure that everything is stable and they do not have asthma. Because the good thing, again, I'll say in asthma is that it is a reversible disease. And we can control it and the patient can be without any therapy for a long time. But it needs regular follow-up, of course.
Exactly. You mentioned about diagnosing. It's important now we diagnose it.
Of course. Okay.
So in your clinic, how do you diagnose bronchial asthma?
Sure, that's a very good question, actually. To diagnose bronchial asthma, basically, we have to do several things. The first thing that we usually do is asking the patient some questions regarding the symptoms, regarding the triggering factors, and other things that we ask, family history, for example, and other diseases that is related to asthma. And then usually what we do some physical examination to see if the patient is more likely to have asthma. And then basically there are tests that are really important to be done to make sure that the patient is asthmatic. And this test is called the blowing test. We call it spirometry. It's a very easy test, accessible, and doesn't take a lot of time, maybe 10 minutes to be done. And it will tell us if the patient has asthma or no, and the severity of asthma as well. And sometimes this test can be normal, and we have other tests that can be done as well. So basically, it's not just doing tests, it's taking history, physical examination, and some investigations that will help us. We can do as well allergy testing, skin prick testing, and other stuff in the clinic.
And the idea is also to rule out other diseases.
Of course, this is very important. Yeah. As I said before, it's very important to make sure that the patient really suffers from asthma other than other diseases, because as we said before, the symptoms might be similar.
Yeah.
So we need to differentiate because the treatment is different. It's not the same.
Exactly. And that leads me to my next question, which is the treatment of bronchial asthma.
Sure. Well, the treatment is usually we have several things that should be done. First of all, if there is a triggering factor or allergic asthma, what we call, the patient should avoid those. For example, if the patient is a smoker, should quit smoking. If the patient has like pets or birds that is related to his asthma, we have things to be done to let the patient either live with such pets or sometimes avoid it completely. It depends on the level. And then as well, we have to avoid as much as we can triggering factor. However, as you know, here in Kuwait, our weather is different and you cannot just tell the patient the whole year stay at home, you know. So we have to tell them what to do to prevent the asthma exacerbation as much as we can. Plus, we have other medication. Our medications are usually not tablets or other things. It's usually, we call it inhalers, in which we give the patient an inhaler device. It has a medication. Usually that medication, what it does is bronchodilates the airways and open them up and prevent the anti-inflammatory that is occurring. So they have to, sometimes a lot of patients think that when we give them an inhaler, this is not a drug. They have to know that in asthma, we don't usually give tablets, we give inhalers. So it's important to be compliant.
Okay. But are there any other systemic medication that the patient actually, because I know some some patients, they do take other medications.
But this is usually in severe cases, in severe cases. And nowadays, we have a lot of biologics in which we give the patient an injection every 2 weeks or every 4 weeks or sometimes monthly. And but this is not to all. It depends on the category of disease, whether allergic, non-allergic, what kind of allergy. So we have other, but the mainstay of therapy, they have to know that it is inhaler. And the mainstay of therapy in asthma is corticosteroids. So they have to know that some patients come and tell me, doctor, I don't want give me anything. I don't want steroids. They have to know that asthma is an inflammation. So the mainstay of therapy is steroids. And the good thing is that we give it via an inhaler. So the systemic side effects is not there usually.
Yeah, the intake basically.
So it's usually very safe to be taken. We give it to children, kids, and even pregnant ladies. So it's a very safe drug. And I always tell them, don't be afraid when you hear a corticosteroid. So that's why whenever they hear a corticosteroid, they tell me, no, 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 I don't want the therapy, or they just take it for 1-2 days and leave it.
Okay.
So it's important that we communicate with the patient and explain for them how safe it is to take that such medications.
Okay. Now I want to shift our attention to your office, your clinic, your unit at Jabal Ahmed Hospital and all the wonderful work you guys are doing. If you can tell us about Jabal Ahmed Hospital's efforts in managing such respiratory diseases.
Sure. Basically, I can tell you in few words, as you know, in 2020, we had the COVID pandemic and Jabir Hospital was the main hospital in Kuwait for COVID. So, and us as a respiratory unit, COVID was mainly a respiratory disease. So we were doing really good, we were doing really great, and things were doing really well. So after COVID, so we were like, for a whole 1.5 years, we used not to do anything except for COVID. But after COVID, alhamdulillah, we are open. We opened up more, and we have now different diseases that we treat. Different clinics. We have multidisciplinary team clinics as well. And I'm proud. I always say I'm proud to say that we have the first and only multidisciplinary clinic in allergy in Jabir Hospital, in which myself, Dr. Abdullah Al-Badr, who is an ENT consultant, and Dr. Yasmin Al-Uthman, who is an immunologist, we stay together and we discuss the patient with the patient to see the best treatment for them. We have as well an interstitial lung disease MDT clinic. We have as well a pulmonary hypertension clinic. And we do, of course, manage the inpatient. And we have different procedures that we do, like bronchoscopies, EVIS, sleep studies, different things that we do.
Well, we do appreciate all the valuable work that you do and to provide for our patients. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have. I have so many questions I couldn't cover, but hopefully we'll be able to host you again in the program. Thank you so much for all the valuable information, the time you shared with us.
Thank you so much for inviting me. And I hope that whoever's listening will just take a good information. And thank you so much.
I'm sure they are. Thank you so much. Dear viewers, we'll still have more for you. Stay with us. We'll be right back.